Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Above the Bar podcast, where each week we belly up to the bar with a new guest, find out what they do, who they are, and what makes them great. So sit back, relax, and enjoy. Alrighty, folks, welcome back to the Above the Bar podcast. It's your host, Sean. We've bellied up to the bar again. The last Wednesday of the month of March, we're getting ourselves together here. I just realized if you were looking for us over on Instagram, I cut the thing off, so I fixed that real quick. This is, you know, and that's perfect because, you know, what we're talking about today is the most improving music. Next, I think this is where jam bands wish they had been, but this is the birth of that type of music where it all really starts from. So I figure what better way to discuss that type of music than a gentleman who has had, I think he actually wrote his first song as Moses was parting the Red Sea. He's been doing this for that long. So I think this is absolutely just the perfect genre of music. And he helped me to impress myself earlier when I realized that I actually had pronounced the name correctly, his name. So joining us today, coming all the way from, and not Gloucesterbury, he's in Connecticut. Joining us is Mr. James A. Norkawich.
Hey, Sean, how you doing?
Look at that. I bring the applause, and I jacked up the entire, see, this is what drives me nuts. So they have this whole thing where you can do TikTok or Instagram now, and then I messed it up. And now I'm trying to put it back, and it's not working right. And I'm sorry, bro. I've jacked this whole entire thing up. So let's try this again. So how are you there, James?
Doing good. Doing good. How about yourself?
I am good. And you get to see all. See, this is the whole thing with doing live, which I think you respect completely. When you do things live, whether you like it or not.
And if it does, it's kind of like the perfect storm, you know. You're
100%.
You know, this went well, and then let's repeat it tomorrow, and it's even more of a basket case than it was, you know.
Yep. So we'll see if this ever picks up here. Oh, look, it picked up. We're good. So now we're live over on Instagram. That's to my left. So if you see me looking left, that's because somebody's over there. But let's get into some house cleaning here, real quick, folks. As always, over my right shoulder, we have the big board for sticker and a cause. If you've got something you're supporting, something you believe in, something that you think is important, reach, and you've got a sticker for it, reach out to me on Facebook, LinkedIn, YouTube, Twitter, Twitch, TikTok, Instagram, all those kind of places. I'll do my best to go ahead and we'll read about it here live on the air. We'll put your sticker up. It's a little free publicity. So again, sticker and a cause, folks, Facebook, LinkedIn, YouTube, Twitter, Twitch, Instagram, all those places. And if you're finding us here right now and you're finding James through me or me through James, make sure you're giving this a like, a share, and a follow. All those things that make this message get found a little bit faster. All that stuff there now. And the last thing, most important, we got to pay bills. You know what I'm saying, James? Bills are, unfortunately, are a thing. And we have our sponsor, Budget Blinds of East Greenbush and Budget Blinds of Hudson and Coxsackie, New York. Budget Blinds is the largest window treatment company in in North America, and they specialize in any and all forms of custom drapery. There is no shape that they can't cover. They do shutters, they do drapery, they do a little bit of everything, and they are basically your concierge service for window treatment. So if you're up here in the Capital Region, the Hudson Valley, reach out to your local Budget Blinds, or if you're close enough and you know where Budget Blinds of Hudson and Coxsackie, New York is, or Budget Blinds of East Greenbush, reach out, let them know you're there to belly up to the bar, and they're going to go ahead and take care of you and give you a 15% discount off your entire order for just telling them that you're there to belly up to the bar. All right, James, all that stuff is done.
We won't throw you any shade.
No, but wait, hold on. Did you hear that one? Did the sound effects coming through?
No, not yet.
What? Oh, hold on. We got to fix that. We can't have the sound effects not coming through. I mean, that's vitally important. I know why. Fix that. Let's see.
Hey, it was an impromptu, but
here we go. Let's try this. Did it come through that time?
Yeah, there we went. There we go.
Right. We got to fix that. You know, you got to make sure that all your sound effects are coming through. Again, I told you, live. So let me make sure, like, legitimately, I know we're joking around about this a little bit beforehand, and I'm horrible with names, but you're in Glastonbury, Connecticut, correct?
Correct.
Been involved in jazz music for 35 years. Did I see that right?
Yeah. And the funny part is tomorrow's my birthday, so.
Well, happy birthdays.
Thank you. It's getting closer to, not close to the big 5-0, but we're getting there. But jazz is my music of choice, so to speak. I mean, listen, I do everything, but it's kind of the fundamental and of who I am and what keeps me grounded in every other style of music.
Well, I guess it kind of brings up the question, and we'll start with this. So what got you actually into jazz music itself? I mean, that's one of those kind of, you know, a lot of kids, you hear about it in the school systems. It's kind of a starting point because it can be you can be extremely creative with jazz music because of the ability, and you correct me on any of this if I'm absolutely wrong, but just that ability to kind of have one person break off, play their own thing while everybody else maintains the beat. Am I explaining it right?
Well, it started like, you know, so I started playing when I was three. I got one of those little chord organs and I guess my parents and my grandparents felt like, you know, well, let's just see what, you know, bang around on it and see what happens. And then I started to hear things and create things and to process things. And so then it went a little upgrade from Santa Claus a couple years later. And I remember there was a whole book of, you know, music, and I pretty much spent the entire day learning every song in there and then played it. And so then that went to piano and taking piano lessons. But funky thing is that my grandfather was an ear player and had 13, 14, maybe, organs in his home.
Really?
It's like having a car collection. I mean, he had the Rolls Royces, he had the Yugos.
Be my age. You must be like right around 46, 47, 48 to even bring up the Yugo.
Oh yeah, Yugo with T tops and a spoiler. That's what I'm talking about.
That's what I'm saying right there.
So I kind of toggled back and forth between the organ and the piano because, well, the piano teacher I had, you know, God rest her soul, she's got to be passed on by now.
Should be 140 already.
Yeah, literally. I was getting it, but I wasn't vibing it. But it really wasn't until, you know, I mean, so the thing is, to answer your question, I grew up playing the music that my grandfather grew up on, which was all, you know, post-World War I, World War II, and that really falls into what I call the Song Sung American Songbook.
Okay, yep.
Which is your classic jazz, you know, My Funny Valentine, you know, 5'2", Eyes of Blue, all that good stuff, you know. And I really didn't. And, you know, on top of that, my grandfather had gotten me into theater organ, which that's a whole different, you know.
What is theater organ?
So theater organ, you know, back in the days before motion pictures,
Okay.
When they had the
Black Panther. It was the soundtrack. It was physically the soundtrack for the movie that someone was playing.
Yeah, totally. I was exposed to meeting a lot of those people who were actually the game changers in radio. So like Radio City Music Hall has an organ. Most of the biggest venues all across, you know, New York State, Connecticut, Massachusetts have a pipe organ. And that pipe organ was, you know, you have to have be involved in a master class to actually learn how to play that thing. And from the age of probably about 10 to 14, you know, they had once a month concerts locally we'd go to. And then when I was in high school, we actually went down to Florida. The only time I've actually flown.
Really?
Yeah. That soon will change with everything that I've got going on, I hope. They had a big organ convention. Needless to say, I was the youngest person there.
Yeah, I'd imagine.
But it was setting me up for, you know, for many things to come, and you know, opening my mind musically. And I think that's the biggest thing when your ears are processing and you're learning and you're listening.
Right.
And you may not even be playing, but you're actually just listening. You know, you're starting to open that conversation. You know, and again, that kind of conversation was, you know, let's, you know, what is this style? What's this thing with jazz? So, we go into high school, which is really kind of interesting because after my sophomore year, my principal had introduced me into a program in the arts. It was like the fame school of music. So long story short, part of your high school day, you go to the University of Bridgeport or where I'm from, and you're learning from people in the industry. And, you know, jazz theory, jazz history, jazz composition. And you're also, you know, playing in a real-time setting. So the cool part was you're also earning college credits while you're in high school. You know, what an amazing experience, you know, that was working with those teachers. And since you actually still some of those teachers and professors I've stayed in contact with, and we worked on many projects together. So, you know, and then from there, college, and then beyond. So.
I mean, I think I have to say for a second, hold on a second, James. You're making it like, yeah, so I just played some music. I mean, I was all right. let's roll this back for a minute. You know, I'm looking at my notes here. Like I said, over 35 years, you started Studio 55 in 1989.
Right.
Now, so that means you were still in high school or even younger when you started that. Am I doing my math right?
That's right. So, you know, back then it was, you know, let's go back to, I was like a freshman in high school. So everything that I was doing, I was kind of just, you know, I had the idea and I wanted to put things together. And, you know, what did I want to put together? And, you know, so over all this time, just putting my catalog, putting things together, studio works, you know, live performances, which we'll get into, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
And.
Well, I mean, and just for, you know, for those of you that are joining us, and again, as I always say, if you're finding us through James or James through us, please take a moment and go ahead and, you know, ask me questions. Listen to Nathan already. Way to make him feel older, Sean. Listen to me. You should be happy. Listen, you should be kind to your elders there, Nathan. You know, be kind to your elders. I want to play this for you real quick. So we picked this up earlier, and I closed it, but didn't name it. So we've got a little piece. This says it was dedicated to Bob. Who was Bob?
So I had a Boston Terrier. So I met my wife in 2014. And of course, when I met my wife, she had maybe 6 months before that adopted. She wasn't my wife yet, but So Bob was just this amazing terrier that we had, Boston Terrier. Just he passed in August of last year, and it was, when you lose any animal, any pet, it's tough. And you know, and you know, the way us musicians do it is we put it into music.
This is how you grieve.
Yeah.
Well, let you know, we're going to dedicate this one to Bob. And the name of this one is again?
That's the Rainbow Connection.
All right, here we go. Rainbow Connection for Bob. Little piece of that. I got to ask a question. I know my fade failed us. And folks, look, James will tell you, I put this all together like 5 minutes before we started. I was like, crap, I didn't grab your music. But was that the Kermit the Frog music?
Yeah.
That, like, I heard it. I was like, wait a sec.
I know that. As you're like, Kermit. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that was,
you, again, showing our age. Listen, folks, welcome to the senior hour. Two old guys from who grew up in the 80s. Like, when we hear music, we're like, hey, let me associate that with a cartoon.
Sponsored by AARP.
I mean, so, but I get it. I feel it. But so you, I mean, your career, but you also told me something before that wasn't in your bio that I find absolutely fascinating. You truly, when some people say, oh, I've dedicated my life to music, and they're like I had an uncle who was a Berkeley graduate. I've talked about him on here before. Amazing bass player. Guy, I have a tattoo from the band that he was in that was called Blind Dog Blues Band. My uncle was amazing. But he was also the guy who never realized that you're going to have to get out of the basement at some point in time and get a job. Like, his job was every so often he worked for a florist delivering flowers, but he always thought he was going to make it big in music. Never did. But you did 25 years on terrestrial radio. Did I have that right?
That's right.
So, like, you, when somebody says they dedicated their life to music, you found any way you could to just be involved with music. Am I understanding that right?
Yeah. I mean, you really have to. I mean, so when I graduated college, before I went back to college to get pursue my master's, it was like, you know, like everybody, we picked up the newspaper and went to the classified section to look for a job. And you know, I really, really wanted to get into radio. My grandfather was a ham radio operator. So, you know, I kind of had a little experience here and there. So I got into radio sales, radio production, and then ended up working for the three major radio stations in New York City.
Oh, really?
Yeah. WQHT, Z100, and then CD101.9. I went through the whole Connecticut circuit, you know, from AM to FM, literally every station in Connecticut. The Hot 97 in Scranton, Wilkes-Barre, Pennsylvania.
I used to work out of Allentown and Reading.
Really?
Yes, I did. So my recruiting office in Pennsylvania, I had the Allentown, which covered Allentown, Bethlehem, all the way up into Panther Valley, Jim Thorpe, as you should know well, coal cracker country. Like, you know that term. I had all that. And then I ended up in Reading. And years later, when I was in Reading, we went as far north as Shamokin and as far south as Twin Valleys. So I have been stuck behind Amish on a 2-lane road and not been able to pass because you don't know what's on the other side of the hill. I have never done that. Like, so you understand that pain also.
Oh God! What was weird was the market for music, because in the late 90s, everything was freestyle, was dance. You know, you had, heavy conducive pop, right? And then going all the way in and ended up, interviewing my heroes on the jazz station at from 10 to 3 in the morning. Then you catch 2 hours sleep because you can't get a train out of Grand Central back into Connecticut for another 2 hours. So it's like, sometimes you're like, is this worth it? Because I've got 2 hours and I need a barrel full of coffee just to hop on the train, only to come back home and fall asleep again and then do it hours later. So, but Scranton was a really funky.
It's a unique little area.
It's just like, I love trains and I love that, that whole vibe, right? Sean, I got to tell you, the biggest station was I was literally on the outer fringe of Marywood College, Marywood University.
Okay.
And it happened to be an all girls school, but I ended up friending someone who worked at the radio station.
Is that the one that used to be Beaver?
Yes.
So folks, this is a real thing. That college he's talking about was an all-girls school known as Beaver College before it became Marywood. Yes, it was an all-girls school named Beaver. Insert your own double entendre.
Yeah. Literally, they had carts that were, it was like Sirius XM radio before Sirius XM radio.
Really?
Well,
so you could get away with a lot.
Yeah, you're going to love this. So the biggest listeners were actually in the county jail. So you had a bunch of felons listening just to, really good music. And this girl that I worked with, I was working at a record store in the Steamtown Mall. Oh, my God. Now I remember it.
I'm pulling you back now, Anna.
Yeah. This is the Wayback Machine.
We're getting into the Wayback Machine now.
Oh, my God. So we were spinning real vinyl, all the hair bands. And,
oh, wow.
Yeah. And, and then she made the mistake of putting, I think, Pantera on, and then the phones were locking, just ringing and going absolutely nuts. And I'll never forget.
You see this? Are you seeing this? I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Dude, I gave it the rock and roll and it gave me laser lights.
I'll never forget. Guy calls up and he's like, I like to dedicate that to my cellmate. And his only call, and mind you, the call comes in and says, you have a call from the Southern Shelter Penitentiary, And he's like, I like to call up and I like to make a request. It's like, oh.
Which song was it? Cowboys from Hell, Vulgar Display of Power? I mean, what are we talking about here? Do you remember what it was?
No.
That's so great. If you really, now, James, I'm going to give you one. If you ever get a moment, you can even do it while we're talking here. And I don't know how I could pull it up and show it to you. If you ever get a chance, did you know Pantera used to be a hair band?
You're kidding.
No, if you ever get a chance, so I have a friend of mine who's an amazing drummer, absolutely phenomenal drummer, legitimately was in a Nine Inch Nails cover band that actually made money, like touring cover band, when Bad Fish comes around for, they make real money, but let me see if I can find it. Pantera hair metal. So if you Google, let's see if I can get this, save image as, if I can get this to work, we'll put it under downloads. So,
what's kind of funny is, so when, of course, I had a girlfriend there, and that's kind of why I ended up in Scranton. But she was following when the Google dolls came to town.
Nice.
And she met Johnny Resnick.
Okay. Yep.
A million times. And then, of course, Trent Reznor. That was her second boyfriend.
There you go.
Oh,
my. Are you ready? This is Pantera.
How much hairspray does one group need?
But is that not ridiculous that that's Pantera? Folks, if you don't know who Pantera is, I wish Phil Anselmo, you know, Mr. Like, I'll beat up anybody. Yeah, hairband, glam tarot. I love it. Yeah.
Glam tarot. Yeah. I'll beat you up after I use your mother's lipstick. You know?
After I use all your mom's Aquanet, look at the fight in me. You know,
the struggle. Oh.
The struggle of the hairband. But that's, you know, but I get it. You know, you were of that era. But I just think it's so cool that, like, for you, James, like, you lived, you're living your music. You did that. You've kept the studio up this entire time. Now, one of the other things that when I was kind of like digging into you and reading your backstory that I didn't quite understand it. And one of the other things, so it's kind of two part. I have two things in my head, so I have to keep them organized. What is, you also did classical crossover. What is classical crossover?
So, in 2022, when the whole Ukraine crisis came along, you know, I wanted to kind of make a statement and do something, okay. and kind of help, you know, at that time, you know, based on the knowledge that we had, right? So, what I did was, I put a video together, and then I started just noodling around, and you know, I'm like, I'm gonna compose something great. Mind you, it's like 6 o'clock in the morning. I'm just sitting in boxers and a t-shirt. I know that's quite an image. And I'm going to compose something original. And then I start playing Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah.
Okay.
And just before that, let's go back a week before that whole process, I got on Twitter. So what I did was, I was so proud of this. I posted it on Facebook. I posted it on YouTube, posted it on Twitter. And then a classical crossover vocalist. So it's somebody with classical chops, you know, opera, real heavy, conducive, like serious.
That strong, deep power voice, like a real power voice.
Yeah, total power voice, total musicianship, balls to the wall, sounds just perfect, right? And she said, I'd like to sing on your track. She just happens to be the number one selling classical crossover artist on all of iTunes.
No shit.
Yeah. So we had that conversation, and 12 hours later, when I got it back, even to this day, I mean, it just, I hear it. Yeah. And it had that much of an impact that local news, everybody started in you know, Connecticut, New York, just picked it up, and all of any proceeds or anything that was raised went to One World Kitchen. It's a great cause, you know.
Absolutely.
Because you want to that's the whole thing, is that you want to make a difference, you want to help.
Javier
not
Bourdain. You can see his face. Because he had a restaurant in D.C. that closed before I ever could get a chance, where he did a restaurant based on a 1775 cookbook, I believe it was. And it was like things in the cookbook were like peanut butter and jelly.
Yeah.
Like,
so this gets even crazier. So it did so well in the U.K. It did so well out for this vocalist and for I. Out her way, you know, Ireland and that whole part of the UK.
A little bit more populist type of music. They're a little bit more into that than we are.
You know, Scotland, Poland, you know, all the and the Baltic states. And so then we had another tragedy. So that was the murders in Uvalde, Texas.
Okay. Yep.
So at that time, I started going across YouTube and looking for a tenor that I wanted to sound. Well, I was looking for the sound of Freddie Mercury. So what I did was I found somebody who was close. So I again put the video together and found this gentleman. And actually I have my wife to thank, because I started putting the video together, but you know, you have a woman's touch putting it on the video really, really capped it and captured everything that it needed. And so that immediately the UK stations picked up. So then the funny backstory was, I'm out in the backyard mowing the lawn. All of a sudden I pick up my phone, right? And I'm like, says, international call. You know, I actually thought it was somebody going to sell me, you know, solar panels or, you know, some shit like that, right?
Right. So,
listen, sir, you do need these solar panels on your home.
Oh, yeah. Listen, yeah.
We bring these out. We put them on. You'll love them. Just go with it.
Actually, it was more like, oh, hello, my name is Mike. You know, it's like.
My name is Samuel. You like it? Yeah, no. I found it, folks. If you want to hear it, it's right there under Hallelujah for Ukraine featuring James Norkawich and Ellen Williams on YouTube. I wish I could. I'm not as fancy to be able to kind of drop it in here and everything. But, yeah, I just found it right away.
And then the other one was Who Wants to Live Forever? With Tyrone Piper and myself.
And now, who's Tyrone Piper?
Exactly. That. Yes. Okay. Just throwing that, you know, things in the music business do not go the way they intended. Not based on artists, based on management and everything else. So
right.
The track is out there and it's out there in the world, and that's the most important thing. And
groovy there.
So anyway, I'm out in the backyard, and then I get a call. Yeah, I get a phone call, and I'm like, who is this? Pick it up, and it's like, hi, is this James? I'm like, yeah. And they're like, he's like, are you there? And I said, yeah. I said, who's this? He goes, this is Adam Lambert. As in Adam Lambert, who
Queen Adam Lambert, current singer. No, and like, yet.
And I said, nobody's going to, I have no way of recording this. Nobody's going to believe me, but it's the truth. And he just said that, you know, he goes, you guys really did Freddie Mercury justice. You really did the song justice. And this version, you know, where you capped it off and you did it, it's just, you know, spectacular. So I'm happy with it. And, you know, it further led into more exciting things, because, you know, previous to 2022, I've, you know, kind of in and out of music. You get in that particular phase where, you know, you're doing this, you have life that gets in the way.
And, right.
You know, and priorities, you know, are priorities. But, you know, so I made an admission that I needed to get my stuff out there. And the more that I began to get, you know, my stuff out there, and the more I began to, you know, kind of say, you know, I did that maybe 20 years ago. Let's revisit it and let's open it up again. And let's have this conversation. You know, that was the big thing. And then improving on things that you've played for 100 years, but you know, now you're listening to them for the first time in a different way that you never would have expected. And
so I told you I'm a ninja on this thing, right?
Yeah.
Ninja. You ready? So it's Ellen. Do I have your permission to play this?
Sure.
So it's you on piano, Ellen Williams singing, and
I love the song Hallelujah. It's a very unique song, especially if you've never heard the original. Definitely listen to the original, but go download James's version about 1,000 times just so it has an extra 1,000 to it. But it's such a unique lyrics. You have to listen to the lyrics of the song. But here we go. This is the first 30 seconds of it.
Secret chord that David played, and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? Well, it goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the
Bro, like I legit have chills. Like, not showing up on the camera, but like, that is like her voice, your playing and her voice are so haunting together.
And we were never in the same room. We only had that initial conversation. And that's just what the power of music, the power of, you know, my again, touching on the jazz background, you know, knowing that in my mind that I played it as I wanted to comp for a vocalist. So I'm hearing the vocalist, but I'm actually playing the changes, the arpeggiations, going in and out of keys, so on and so forth, yada yada. And when you get to the crest of where, you know, the video, and then it cuts off, and just what you think it's done, right? Then it's still telling a story. I'm really proud of that. It happened in March of 2022. And, you know, after losing my dad into COVID in 2021, you know, you kind of find yourself, you know, in say, never, my parents never got to hear this stuff. And, but I know they're listening to it. And so, let's give it all we got and let's have the world hear it. And I hope people take a listen to it. Just the images, that video is all me. That music is all me.
That's awesome.
Just took the interpretation of what somebody else laid forth and made it my own. And that's what I think anybody who looking to get into, to be an artist, to be an instrumentalist, I think jazz is the perfect venue because it gives you that levity to go ahead and be yourself and not, there isn't anything that you're not able to do. You know, you can play metal, you can do rock, you can do pop, but if you constrict yourself into one box and you're like, you know, and you're just going to say, I'm going to do this. You're not just getting it, man. You know, you got to be able to soak everything up. It's just like being a Marine, which I know you can identify with, you know,
a little bit.
Have to learn every tactical maneuver. And that's,
you can't just be like, I'm really good at this one thing.
Yeah, no. Being a jazz is being a Marine. You got to know the changes. You got to know the intonation. You got to know your scales. You got to know your keys. You got to know the fake. You got to know, commit it to memory. And then you got to be able to write your own stuff. And always.
Part of jazz, though, like the ability to write your own, like, you know, you can't just play the standards for jazz. You got to have that ability to write it. Like, cause when I think of jazz, here's my mindset of jazz.
Mm-hmm.
I do have a little bit of that, old school movie, like the jazz musician sitting there, you know, where's my fedora? Let me get my fedora so I can do my best jazz musician. Like this is the jazz musician. He's got his fedora on. He's playing, you know, the saxophone or playing the clarinet, and you know, but they're very what's the best way to describe it? It's almost like some people equate it to, like, to know jazz, like a lot of jazz people. And I don't get this vibe from you, so apologize for explaining it this way.
No,
a lot of times the jazz musician is the thinks he's the coolest guy in the room because nobody else knows jazz. Does that make sense the way I'm explaining it?
Oh, totally. And a lot of classical artists are the same way.
Are they the same way?
Well, let me clear that up. A lot of genres, there's a lot of those pretentious.
Is that what it is? Like, you're in this thing. This is my thing. You don't know music.
So when you realize how many jazz artists are musicians, one of my favorite, and I'm getting closer to working with him, David Foster. David Foster wrote for everyone from Earth, Wind, and Fire to Boss Gags. Now, you take Boss Gags. Boss Gags, you know, they're all part of Stevie Dan. Stevie Dan is the biggest entity of jazz music. But they
what? Hold on. Stop. Pause. How is Steely Dan jazz music?
Steely Dan is total jazz.
No.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Listen, Jay Graydon on guitar, David Foster on me. Anybody who's anybody who wanted to be in the realm of being a jazz musician, if you weren't Stevie Dan, you weren't anybody. These guys have insatiable chops and just this awesome tenacity and understand music so well that when they play, there's no BSing around. It's serious.
I would never put, like, because I like Steely Dan. I listen to classic vinyl. You talk about Sirius XM. I listen to classic vinyl. That's my channel. I leave it on.
Listen to Peg. But next time, listen to Peg with the cans on. And listen to what each instrument is doing and how they're having a conversation with one another. I mean, I do that in my originals and even in my covers. But, you know, it's there, you know, these solos, like, you know, on that solo Peg, that was a one-shot solo. And if you go on YouTube and you look at YouTube or very quickly Netflix called Hired Guns, you'll see how these guys really made this stuff work and took their ingenuity and actually conformed it to jazz, but made it pop. So basically, you could say it's a jazz classic. It's a jazz crossover.
That's why, bro. James, you just blew my mind with that, because I wouldn't have put it. But when you say the conversation between the instruments, I can hear that in a Steely Dan song. And look, folks, if you're finding me through James or James through me right now, I see some folks out there watching us. Give us a like, share, follow. That's how this gets found. That's how James's music gets found. You hitting that like button right now, that heart. If you have questions for us about music, you're curious about what he's doing, give it a thing. George, another Marine. We are broadening horizons here. Absolutely.
And on top of that, I played the Tower of Power. Tower of Power is jazz, funk, and R&B all infused together. And then my one gig, which I didn't know, I was asked to do this, played with Chicago. Chicago.
You played with Chicago?
Yeah, one gig.
It doesn't matter. Listen.
And again, jazz. Listen to the horn lines.
I could see that. See, I could see that with Chicago. I definitely can see that with Chicago because of the horns and everything. But I guess I never put the conversation piece together. So you just said it about the jazz instruments and the conversation. So I'm the guy who loves music. I can sit down. Like, my wife will tell you, my Christmas gift that I wanted this year was an old school stack stereo system. I wanted a record player. I wanted a receiver. I wanted my speakers. That's what I want.
I've got about six of those, including the studio in my house.
I love it. And for me, like, listening to music, like, I'm so excited. I don't know if you know who Marcus King is.
Yeah.
So we're going to see Marcus King at the Palace here in Albany on July 13th. And I have, like, I spent the money on seats. We're probably, I think we're like 10 rows from the stage.
I indirectly know him. After the broadcast is over, I can tell you
how. Tell me about it now. Folks, we're getting ready to close the bar here soon. Don't hold back on good stuff, man. Don't hold back till the end.
My ex brother-in-law was actually a good friend of his, and actually probably still is.
I love his music.
Yeah, and he's, you know, again that whole era we grew up. He goes back to like guys like, you know, if you look, you know, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Jeff Healey, oh,
fucking,
you know,
Vaughan Brothers.
Yeah, I mean, it just, and then, well, like something I'm working on right now, which is this is the first time I'm really mentioning it. The artist's name is Samantha Cole. She was big in the late 90s.
Okay.
Worked with Richard Marx, worked with David Foster, you know, and just a huge array of people. So we're now, and she's initially a kind of a pop R&B kind of sound. Now we're crossing over and we're doing something monumental, going into classic country. I can't speak of it much, but if you follow me, you'll see what goes on. And then you say you heard it here. And then hopefully we can revisit this and talk more about it and bring her.
Now, if somebody wanted to find you, where could they find you at right now?
I'm everywhere.
What's it as? If I went on Instagram or LinkedIn, where would I find you as?
LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, TikTok. Did I miss anything?
And folks, it's all as James A. Norkawich. And Norkawich is just how it sounds. It's spelled the same way it sounds. Norkawich, Norkawich. You can find James. Make sure you're liking and following and sharing everything he's got. Brother, told you. Like, let's see if I can, I got the right arm. Look, see. This is the Cocopelli. And it says Rainmaker, because that was Tom Wright and the Rainmakers. Yeah. Was my uncle Mike was the bass player. Tom's still alive. I love music. I can, believe it or not, with the smooth, silky sounds of this voice, I can hold a tune. I can carry a tune. I'm better in acapella than by myself. But I do want to ask this question though. So when you're sitting down. And we're getting close to closing up here, but you're sitting down and you're going to compose something. Do you have a process, or if you knew somebody who was getting into it, how would you recommend for somebody to learn that process to compose a song?
Biggest thing that I was taught by a teacher of mine, Brian Torf, who played with bass for Frank Sinatra, George Shearing, Marion McPartland, and this is when I was 16. Okay. And my other professor who lives in the Hudson Valley, who's worked with Vanessa Williams, Bacon Brothers, yeah, I mean, it's crazy. So the biggest thing is first to listen. I always say classic vinyl. Go to your local Goodwill. You can get vinyl, great vinyl, for a buck. And half the time they don't even know what they're pricing. And I found a lot of really cool stuff, and I like to talk about it on social media. The thing is, when you find an instrument that you like, yes, I do teach virtually too. So, you know, you can always hit me up on social media.
You teach what?
I teach piano virtually.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Gotcha.
But I also, amongst many other instruments, but the thing is always to keep listening, absorb, process, keep focused on the prize. I mean, you know, I guess the biggest thing is not everybody is too worried about playing Eddie Van Halen riffs and not focusing on how Eddie Van Halen got there. And to further make my point, I'm just trying to get everything in. Have you ever seen the movie Whiplash?
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, so that movie was written by a real guy by the name of I just screwed it up. Don Ellis. Don Ellis, if you look Don Ellis up, you're like, who's Don Ellis? He lived a short life, mid-40s. He had a bad heart. But the thing is, he's the original one who wrote Star Wars. He's worked with Quincy Jones. He's worked with all the big players of that time. Miles Davis, John Coltrane. Like you talk about someone who you've never heard of, but you've seen infiltrated in various movies. this is the thing. We are the people that you may not hear of, because jazz is not one of those predominant, you know, fields. If you get to be a Kenny G, Kenny G's from New Haven, Connecticut. I love Kenny, but, you know, he's too commercial. The real guys,
rarity in the industry.
Yeah. I mean, the real guys go in there, they get down, they get dirty, they get nasty, they play. They're hearing, they're vibing, they're feeling, and they're interpreting. You know, everybody goes, what is jazz? The biggest thing from jazz versus anything else is the actual interpretation. How are you going to put your
spit,
your stanking, so to speak, you know, on
a little stank on it.
Yeah, on those changes. It's your interpretation. It's the same 12 notes, but how are you going to put them in along with the chords, along with the bass line, along with the drummer, and make this into something that is universally yours? And that is what jazz is, an interpretive. It's like interpretive dance. It's like contemporary dance. You know, there is no preform limit. You have to follow the road, but how you're going to veer off into any other lane, that's up to you. If you're going to go at a different speed, that's up to you. Same thing is, and then when you start, don't get discouraged. Keep listening, keep practicing. Don't give up, because the payoff ultimately you'll be able to do things that you really never, ever, ever had the capability of actually thinking that you can do or process. I fell into jazz because it was introduced nice and easy, you know. And the thing is, I say, pick up Miles Davis' Kind of Blue, the staple of albums. And then pick up some Boss Gags, pick up some Earth, Wind, and Fire, pick up some Tower of Power. Literally, this is my recipe. You know, I'll send you the bill after this is all done.
I'll pay you the second Tuesday of next week. Just don't worry about it.
Yeah, for a hamburger today, right?
Right. Check's in the mail. Don't worry about it.
The thing is, you know, listen, you know, some people are rhythmically challenged. Some people have a technical ability that is unforeseen. Listen, I swore that I hated classical music. I can play any Rachmaninoff piece you want, up and down, left and right. But it's not my genre. You know, I want something that grooves. I want something that rocks. You know, something that's going to vibe me on a different day, at a different time, at a different hour. And the thing is to always, best thing, create a playlist. Put what entices you. What lights your musical fire? What pops your musical cherry? As in that movie, That Thing You Do, you know? I mean, you know, it's like whatever gets you going and whatever motivates you, you're going to start connecting all these entities back and forth. And then when you make that connection, then you begin to develop your own sound. When you begin to develop your own sound, hook up with some other people, have that conversation back and forth, you know? And then, you know, you got to get the fundamentals down. I mean, no one wants you to, you know, it's like, look at me, I'm going to solo. Then, you know, no.
They don't want you to be on the recorder.
Yeah, that's not going to work. But music is a way to decompose. No, that's what happens when you don't want to compose. You decompose.
You decompose when you've decided that the song doesn't work. You decompose it and you break it back down to its lowest form, and then come back at it again.
Again, the old adage: the old musicians never die; they just go from bar to bar. You know, but it's musical. Music is just. Is my life, and
it's a connection. Like they say that math is the universal language. Every culture, if I hold up two fingers, they know I'm talking about two. But music is math. Call it right. What it is.
That's the biggest thing, is that people don't realize when you study the arts and you play music that you're learning about history. You're learning about math. You're learning about sciences. And if you're a big science geek, you want to get into the whole technical sound of how to build and how to affirmate, you know, the actual people who put everything behind this, you know, because, yeah, I'm also the sound engineer. I'm like a Jamaican. I got 40 jobs. You know, It's like, you know, that old In Living Color scene, you know, how many jazzmen have you? And when will it be a jazz weekend?
So Manny, I think, Manny, you're still down in Philly. Are you back up in the Capital Region? He's another Marine, great dude, but he's kind of, you're kind of in between the two of us. And Manny, if you haven't been to Jazz Fest up at SPAC, I know we, James and I were talking about this. That is like 2 days. My wife is a big, not Natalie Merchant. God, I can't think of her name right now. That was a jazz singer. We went and saw her. That's where I saw Grace Kelly, who's an amazing jazz musician. She's a little tiny thing. I saw a jazz harp. Let's put it that way. But anything coming up that Manny could head up to?
I mean, just stay tuned with social media. I mean, I'm starting going again with that artist, Samantha Cole. I don't want you to forget that name.
Samantha Cole. Yep. I'm going to look her up here in a moment.
And Samantha and I and my entourage of people, there's going to be a lot of things that we're going to, you know, from, you know, anywhere from casinos to smaller venues. And we hope to get down to actual South Philly, New Jersey, go out towards Pennsylvania way, upper New York State. And then
I'll make it up here.
I mean, there's so much going on right now that please, you know, follow me. I'm very interactive. I will tell you, hey, you know, we may be going here, we may be going there. Right now, there's literally two huge projects going on right now. I'm sworn to secrecy. I don't have to tell the world, but
she made it to number 78 on the Billboard Hot 100. And number 55 on the Canadian RPM. It also reached number 35 and 38 in American pop rhythmic radio, radio and records. That was her song, Happy With You.
Yeah. She's
going to shoot tacos and tequila. And so this is Latin jazz. I've seen Manny post about this Latin jazz, and we're so close. What is the difference in Latin jazz and American jazz? What do we give me, like, the Reader's Digest versions?
Reader's Digest version. Well, I've done two Latin Christian albums, so now we're even getting deeper than that. So Latin is highly infused, more highly rhythmic. You know,
danceable. Is it more danceable kind of jazz?
More danceable, and is very conducive chop wise. So, you know, if you're a guitar guy, listen to Mike Stern, and anything Mike Stern has ever done, you're gonna hear like chops galore. You know, Yellow Jackets, Spyro. You know, and Spyro does actually a lot of Latin jazz. David Samuels, may he rest in peace. He was the vibraphonist. He was a good friend. He was from Spyro. He was one to infuse a lot of like morning dance, that which you would consider Latin jazz.
And for those who don't know what James is talking about, he's talking about Spyro Gyra, which was a huge band. Here you go. He's talking about Manny, watch this. Umberto Ramirez. You didn't know I could roll my tongue. Umberto Ramirez. You didn't know I had the tongue. I have to flip my hands when I do it. I can't roll my tongue any other way.
I've got one quick story. So when I was 15, my cousin Peter, who also is a musician, he pulls out of the clear blue sky Spyro Gyra's Free Time album, says to me that this album will save your life. And I'm thinking, at 15, what the hell is he talking about? Believe it or not, I didn't know that 10 years later, I would be doing Northeast leg of their tour and knowing them and working with them. And, you know, again, music can bring you to places that you've never been and before. And I always say, music is the soundtrack of our lives. So why not make it a good one?
Brother, I am loving every bit of what you're saying. As I always say, folks, look, you know, take the time. Look up James A. Norkawich. He's on all of his social medias, all the same. Norkawich is Norkawich. If you're into music, hopefully maybe we'll get him up here in the Capital Region. You know, he's only in Connecticut. He's a couple hours away from us. So come out. If he plays in the area, I'll make sure we all know about it. We got something going on here. See what he got going on. I love every bit of what you have here. If you like what he's got going, we always got something new coming on. Real quick, do you, James? I mean, this is kind of going into the whole jazz piece. You know, the idea that most jazz musicians were smoking the wacky tobacco and drinking and all that. That was the old kind of way of looking at it. But I'm a fan of, I know I like my bourbons and my ryes, but I'm a fan of gin. Do you like gin?
This is the funny part. I'm a musician who's never drank and has never done drugs. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm okay with the never done drug, but never drank?
No, just music. Music's my thing, man.
Your drug.
Yeah, music is my drug. And the higher I am musically, like my Christmas album, like in this past Christmas, the album got 7.5 million streams worldwide in
53
countries. So I was drunk, hungover, and...
All from downloads. I'm giving you that. Well, here coming up, I just want to let everybody know on not next week, but on the 10th, we actually, you ever seen the show Downton Abbey?
Yeah.
We actually have there's two people that own a gin brand. We'll talk about it more next week before that show comes up. But we're having one of the other owners that own that castle from Downton Abbey. We're talking about their gin in 2 weeks. And then next week, we have staying with our generation, bro. Generation Z, generation lost, generation we have no identity. We actually have a gentleman coming on that's going to talk about offering, specializing in Gen Z and millennials. He's a motivational Gen Z and millennial podcast and author talking about millennial leadership. He's a professor, consultant. His name is Jason Wiggins. We're going to be talking about that next week. So make sure you're tuning in again next week. As I always say, make sure you like, share, and follow. There's always something going on. We've got all of our social media pieces. So now, James, I know you binged all, whatever this is. I think this is 227 or 230 episodes of the show. You've sucked them all in, as you do with your music. You've sucked it. Hey, did you pay attention to the opening music?
Mm-hmm.
So that was actually written just for me by a very good friend of mine, Jim's son, Jay, who Jay has Asperger's, but is a musical savant.
Wow.
When I say savant, I mean, have you ever watched the docufilm about Elton John where the music teacher plays the piano and then he plays exactly the same thing and stops and she's like, well, why did you stop? And he goes, you didn't play anymore.
Yeah, that's again, and the healing power of music.
Oh,
people who are in a nursing home or comatose, practically. My grandfather used to, you know, just pop in, play the organ, and all of a sudden the mind ticked back up, and they were able to relive all those beautiful memories because music just creates that healing power. It just creates that side of the brain that brings us to the place that we need to be. It cures depression, it cures anxiety, cures everything. And it would solve a lot of the world's problems if we listened to more music and cut the BS out.
If we all sat down, listened to a song and drank a bourbon together, we'd all be a hell of a lot happier. Maybe take an edible too, a little spicy candy might help a little bit, but you know, I'm just saying. But back to where we're at. So I love you. Hopefully you've binged all these different episodes and Jay wrote that for me. I'm always proud of that like he just wrote that. But as we do on every episode, and I always say, don't log off on me right after this. We got to talk for just a minute. We'll talk in our little private session here for a moment. But as I do with every guest, and you probably already know this is coming up, the guest always gets the final word. James, what's our final word?
Final word is, you know, you have the chance. Everyone has the chance to make a difference. And, you know, I hope in some way anything that I've said is some little, you know, if you're just coming across and you're looking to, you know, you want to get into music, but you don't know how, you know, the biggest thing is ask, because there are a lot of people that love to share what they do and how they do it with you. And I just happen to be one of those people. So make sure you like, follow, subscribe, and, you know, and drop me an email. I always love to talk to people and see what they're thinking, and always like to work with different artists. You can never stop making music.
Alrighty, folks, be sure to push your stool in. This has been a Second Front podcast presentation, found on Apple, Spotify, and wherever podcasts can be found.